Clara. Hi, Ken in Oregon. Oh, it's so good to see your faces. Hi, Teresa. Hi, Dave in Orange County. Hello, welcome. It is Friday, and it is time for us to all gather together in virtual support group land to connect to a community of care and resources. One amazing resource that we have is Dance for PD. And we're so excited today to have the founding teacher and program director of Dance for PD joining us from New York, David Leventhal. So hello, David. And as always, just to say hi, my name is Andrea Merriam. I'm with Parkinson and Movement Disorder Alliance. It's been so great to have this series, and we're so thankful to our neurologist host, Dr. Subramanian, for putting this together, a way to connect people, you know, across the country while we're in these strange homebound times. So excited to be able to share education and resources and a little avenue for socialization. So with that, I'll kick it over to you, Dr. Subramanian.
Thank you. Well, thanks so much. It's so exciting to meet David finally virtually. I've seen you present at some previous events that I've been on, and just really, really awesome to have, to be able to showcase the wide array of things that people have championed across the country and across the world for Parkinson's patients. As many people know, we've been talking a lot on this series about staying socially connected, and I think dance is something that really you can do that fosters that. And often, you know, in other times when we're not so distanced physically, we can physically connect through dance as well, which I think is really magical, and share musical connections and things like that. Who doesn't like to dance? I think it's just really fun to have all kinds of options. I think we've had a number of folks talk about exercise and what brings you joy is something that you should choose. And I think a lot of people love dancing. And it's great to be able to sustain the ability to dance or connect with something like this after being diagnosed with Parkinson's. And it's something that you can do with your caregiver and your families as well. So definitely excited to have David on. Thanks again, PMD Alliance, for hosting, and welcome everyone. So I wanted to ask David, I know that you're sort of based in New York, which has been a big sort of highly affected by this COVID situation, and a lot of folks have had a lot of stressors in healthcare, as well as a lot of families and patients who have been sick with the virus. And so thank you for taking the time from, you know, this location. I might ask you some questions specifically around how New York is doing in a minute, but maybe you could just introduce us a little bit to who you are, how you got interested in dance in the first place in your own life, and then what brought you to working with Parkinson's patients.
Sure. Well, thank you very much for having me on this call. I'm thrilled to have a chance to share with all of you, to meet all of you virtually. Not sure I'm even that crazy about that word. I feel like I am meeting you. We just happen to be online. It's real, folks. This is a real way to meet. We're just not shaking hands. So anyway, thank you for the honor of being able to share a bit. So I've been dancing since I was 8. So almost 40 years. It's really one of my only passions. And I trained primarily in ballet, but when I got to college, I focused a bit more on modern dance and then moved to New York right after college to audition. And I gave myself 3 years. I said, if I can try to make it in New York as a dancer in 3 years, I'll stay doing this. And if it doesn't work out, I'll do something else. Then the first year I started working with Mark Morris's company. Mark Morris Dance Group is a very established touring modern dance company. It's been going 40 years. We celebrate our 40th anniversary in the fall. And I always loved Mark's work because growing up in Boston, Massachusetts, it was one of the few companies that came through. And so I knew this work. I loved how musical it was. I loved how expressive it was. The dancers had personalities. They weren't just cut out figures that replicated each other. And I loved the individuality of it. So when I, we are seeing someone's screen there. When I moved to New York, I asked this question, how do you get to audition for Mark's company? And I had a friend who let me know about an audition. Anyway, I'll bore you the detail, boring me the details, but I started working with Mark's company sort of on a freelance basis for a year and then got hired full time. And that was it. And then about 4 years after I joined, we opened a new dance center in Brooklyn, which is actually where I'm calling you from today. And we started opening our doors to the community. One of the people who came through that door and said, I'm the community, is a woman named Ole Westheimer, who's the founder and former executive director of the Brooklyn Parkinson Group. And Ole had a vision for a support group that was more than conversation, more than getting together to talk. She really wanted people to do something meaningful together. And for Ole, who had a dance background, that activity was dance, first and foremost in her mind. And when she saw this building open in 2001, she said, I bet they'd be interested in this. She didn't know much about us, but she knew that we were what I would call a humanist organization. Mark's dances are they're very human. They look like anybody can do them. They're very difficult, but they have a kind of human dimension to them. They're very musical. They draw from dance traditions around the world. And I think she felt like this was going to be a good home for her idea. At that time, though, and a lot of you know this, it was really a hunch. In 2001, there wasn't a lot of evidence on exercise in Parkinson's. There was certainly nothing on dance in Parkinson's. A few people were doing kind of a dance-based exercise program, but they hadn't come to call it dance. And we were the really first ones to say, this is a dance program. And actually, what dancers train to do for years and years is really applicable to people with Parkinson's. And you think about dance training, you think about coordination, you think about sequencing movements, right? A to B to C. You think about engaging music as a tool. You think about social interaction, touch, focus, contact. You think about the space around you. How do you navigate that space? You think about quality of movement. How do you move? Not just what are you doing, but how are you making choices? How are you initiating? So when you come down to it, I always say this, but if you were to sit in a lab and concoct a movement program that was particularly focused for Parkinson's, it would end up looking a lot like dance, really, because everything that dancers do is directly relevant to people living with PD. The thing I really like about dance, and I got involved, I taught the very first class here. I was asked if I would co-teach with a colleague, John Higginbotham. The thing that I liked about it is that Parkinson's is a multifocal condition, right? It's not just a movement disorder. It's a quality of life challenge, right? Everything in your life is addressed in Parkinson's. And dance is also a multifocal intervention, if you want to call it that, right? It is physical, it's very physical. It's also cognitive, right? We're always thinking about what we're doing. We're using imagery and music. It is social, you know, for people who feel cut off from other social networks. The dance class, even in an online setting, is a way to connect. It's a way to belong. And finally, a piece that doesn't get a lot of talking about in sort of medical communities, but this expressive sense, this sense that as Parkinson's takes away facial expression, takes away voice, takes away big movements that we might use to express ourselves, dance helps people bring some of those back into their toolkit in a way and gives them a chance to explore those elements in a very safe and supportive way. So we don't have to do facial exercises in class because we're doing West Side Story and we're doing role playing and we're doing characterizations that might happen in dance. And people end up using their faces more than they do in daily life because they're expressive dancers. And so it's, that's really what I like about it. I don't have to be afraid that I'm missing something that's critical. If I teach a really well-balanced, legitimate dance class, it hits all of the points I think that people need to work on.
Wow. You're so passionate. It just comes through in your own facial expressions and your hand movements and everything you've said. It's just really heartwarming. I have a yoga background and I've really been trying to do something very similar. And when you're passionate about something and it has so fed your soul in some way, it's sort of, you know, something that you want to share with the world. And when you've seen patients thrive and do well and transform, and I think it's kind of a magical thing. So it's clear that you've dedicated, it sounds like 19 years just with the Parkinson's patients, and such an amazing story that you were the first teacher and have continued this, you know, diaspora, I guess, because I know you've done a lot of teaching. So I have a few questions from what you just said, because you said a number of things that tweak my interest. So maybe tell us a little bit about where you have taught around the world, because I know you guys have spread to many places. So you started in that the one here in Brooklyn, yep. Where you are. Are you in the studio now? Is that what you said, or this is your home?
I'm in the studio. I have a background, because my background right now is really drab.
And I was going to say, you look like you're in your living room, and I love it.
It's very drab here, and it's very quiet. Our office has been closed for 7 weeks.
Okay.
So it's a little bit depressing. So that's why I have a cheerier background.
I'm going to ask you where you got the cushions, but I'll save that.
I'll let you know later. Yeah.
There are two
real ways. So the Mark Morris Dance Group is a touring company. So when I was still dancing with the company, which I did for about 15 years, we would offer this class on the road wherever we performed, whether that was in Urbana-Champaign or Tel Aviv, Israel, or London, England. We would work with local partners there and offer this class. That's a big way that the program started to spread from just Brooklyn to the 25 countries where it's currently operating. And what would happen is we go in, we teach a class, people would say, that was great, when's the next class? And we'd say, well, we're on tour, we're not coming back for 2 years. They say, what do you mean? So we started teaching local teachers, local dance teachers, to do this work. And so we started training. So the training program started around 2007. So when I'm teaching, I'm out on the road either doing classes for the community and sort of demonstrating what the program is, and or I'm also doing a training workshop for instructors. And so most recently, there's been a lot of interest in Asia. So my work both on the community side and on the training side has been in China, in Japan, in South Korea primarily. But we have a large network in Europe, particularly in the UK, which is few years ahead of us in terms of this whole arts and health field. There's a large network in Australia and a large network in the US. So we have classes in about 270 communities throughout the US. Some of those communities, there are multiple classes, like I see some of you calling in. I see Clara from Los Angeles. Los Angeles, there are a number of different programs going on. Seattle has 5 or 6 locations. Washington, D.C. has 5 or 6 locations. New York has 9. So in a lot of those communities, there are multiple options for people, which we love. And right now, all those locations have moved online. So, you know, we're now offering Zoom classes every day. We have up to 140 people a day joining those classes from all over the world, which for me is the silver lining, you know, because I love teaching our group in New York, and I love traveling out on the road and teaching people, but they haven't until now come together. And now, thanks to technology, our New York dancers dance with the group from Germany, dance with the group from Australia, dance with the group from California, and it's kind of an amazing thing that we probably won't stop even when we've returned to some kind of live experience, because it's been so inspiring. Yeah. Sure. So that's really the story of sort of how things got replicated. Or I love the word diaspora. That's exactly what it is.
So when you teach in these other countries, do you change the music up to reflect something about the places that you're going?
Yeah, great question. Yes. So one of the things that we really never want to be accused of is cultural imperialism. We want, particularly when we're training, we want teachers to adopt sort of the teaching practices that we've established, but it's their responsibility to own the content, and we want them to develop their own content. So a great example of this is in Pune, India, where there's been a program for a number of years, at least 8 or 9 years, in conjunction with a clinic there, the Sanchiti Clinic. And when that group came to train with us, we were really clear with them that we wanted them to adapt our approach to Indian traditions, Indian dance traditions, which are much stronger and older than our traditions. So we wanted to honor that and not say, well, you gotta do, you know, ballet and Broadway. So their class, they really took the core of what we do, but instead of doing a modern tap and ballet combination warm up, they do Kathak, which is a traditional classical Indian form, very rhythmic, very percussive, and that's their warm up. And then for the second part of class, which is more sort of free movement, big movement across the floor, they use Bollywood style choreography. So I like using that example because it's a great mirror of sort of making, it's the same model, you recognize the progression, but it's just different software, right, plugged in there. But it's the same hardware, it's the same structure, the same approach, with an appropriate content. And of course, we want teachers to teach what they love. You know, I think one of the challenges of I don't like using the word, but replicating a program is that everybody becomes a robot and kind of everybody has to, they feel like they have to teach the same thing. And I think what makes this program tick is that teachers are teaching what they love and sharing that with their communities. So even within the US, where there's still a lot of diversity, cultural diversity, we have classes that are flamenco classes, popping classes, tap classes, salsa classes. They all fall under Dance for PD, but they obviously use very different styles. And we love that. That's really important to us.
Oh, cool. I love that too. So there's a couple questions that have come in. Betsy said, dancers sound well positioned to deal with Parkinson's. I wish I was a dancer prior to diagnosis. I mean, I think a lot of people wish a lot of things, you know, but I think, could you speak to that? Because I think even with the yoga scene, we've sort of had this sort of preconceived notion that people have to be really, you know, bendy or really, you know, presumably coordinated for dancers or already have a sense. But are you able to teach people who have two left feet in your group? Okay.
Oh, yes. We welcome, I mean, for one thing, when you come into the class, you are already a dancer, right? You're not a patient. That's really an important principle for us. This is not a clinical space. This is an artistic space, on a virtual, online or in the studio. And so you're already a dancer. Most importantly, whether or not you are moving as you would like to move as a dancer, you have the ability to think like a dancer. That means thinking about rhythm. It means thinking about where all the parts of your body are in space. It means thinking about the quality of movement that you're using as you move through space, or not just the mechanics of it, but how? Are you using a soft movement? Are you doing a sharp movement? Are you moving quickly, slowly? You have so much more control over your movement than we might think about in everyday life. And so we focus a lot on the how, because anybody with an imagination, which is anybody on this call, can harness your imagination in the service of movement. And that's really what dancers do. So even if you go away from that first class saying, well, I wasn't able to do everything, you're already going away with tools about how to think like a dancer. And that's what a dancer is, right? How do you think about movement from the viewpoint of a dancer? You're going to get that from even one class, and then you can adopt that to your everyday life. So yeah, we get a lot of folks who've never danced in their lives. Particularly, I would say a lot of the gentlemen who come into class, they've never felt safe coming into a dance class. They've never seen it as part of their lives. And yet Parkinson's has this amazing way of opening people up to possibilities. I would say in our classes, 40 to 50% of the participants are men, and very few of them have danced before. Most of them say, well, I would never dance if I didn't have Parkinson's. But because they have Parkinson's, they're open to a possibility. And once they come to that first class, they say, why didn't I try this before? This is so much fun. It's really social. I get to express myself. I get to tell jokes through my body. It's what this has been missing in my life. So So yeah, we get a lot of people without experience. And what's great to see is we get this question all the time. You know, what are the benefits? Do you see benefits? And there are a number of studies, actually 38 that I know about that have been published on the impact of dance on people with Parkinson's. I can provide a link here in a moment. But what I see as a dancer is that, number one, people are moving with more fluidity over the course of one class. So they come in with rigidity, with some shuffling in their gait. That changes over the course of the class. I'm sure Shannon has seen that too in her work and others who are tuning in. I see people over time becoming much more comfortable with their bodies, much more comfortable with expressing ideas through their physical body, and they become better dancers. So whether or not that's picked up on the UPDRS or the PDQ-39 is up to the researchers to find out. And yes, it does. We do pick up some good readings, particularly on the UPDRS motor scores. But where we're also seeing impact is on things like confidence, self-esteem, social connection, sense of self-efficacy, so that sense that you can do something that you ordinarily didn't think you could do. Those are things that we're really interested in. And so we definitely see good outcomes from that as well. Somebody says two left feet plus one freezes. So yes, we have a number of participants in our New York class who do experiencing freezing. What's really interesting about the dance experience is we see very little freezing during the dance class. You have to think about dance as a series of really strong, impactful cueing systems. So you have somebody in front of you demonstrating movement, a teacher or other participants doing movement in front of you. It's like a living mirror. Number two, you have choreography that has imagery, and that's always very helpful when you're trying to move. It's less helpful to talk about lift your right hand and do 10 presses. Like that's, our brain doesn't awaken to that. But when you think about flapping your arm like a swan or reaching for the sun, or you know, we incorporate some yoga in our class or doing a sun salutation, thinking about light on your arms, that inspires people to think differently. And that detours people around some of the blocks that they might have into a pathway towards movement. And I think the strongest cueing system really is music. And that's what has been researched in literature. We know a bit about how music influences brain activity. We know a bit about how music provides structure for dance, and we know a lot about the value of music for people with Parkinson's. I would say the other part, and so a lot of the freezing tendencies that people have ordinarily, partially mediated by the musical environment that gets created in class. In our New York classes, we have live music, so there's an added kind of energy and even a pulse through the floor that helps people who start to get stuck, and they feel that rhythm actually through the sprung floor. So I think also in terms of the other thing that happens in a dance class is motivation. And this is something that researchers are very interested in, this question of adherence. How closely do people adhere to an activity? I know Dr. Subramanian, you see this in medical treatment too. How closely do people stay with the regimen, whether it's medicine or exercise that you give them? And this is something that, you know, we can give the best possible treatment, but if people don't follow it, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter. It's only as good as that individual is disciplined to follow the treatment. Well, one of the great things about dance is it has a very high adherence rate because it is fun and it's social. So even if you're a little uncertain of the movements, people keep coming back because they want to see their friends and they really like listening to the music and they like doing the dances together. And that in itself is a benefit because it means that regardless of what's going on in someone's week, people are engaging physically in a regular activity. Yes, it might not be as strenuous as say a tandem bike or a treadmill, but those things are harder to maintain in your daily regimen than say a dance class or even a 20-minute dance experience that you can do using one of our DVDs or one of our videos. So I think adherence is a big factor in the success of this program and dance in general, because it's fun. Like, nobody says, I don't feel like dancing today, or they might say I don't feel like moving. But once the music comes on and they have that potential to interact, it's a different story. Dr. Subramanian, I think you're on mute.
Wait, yes, okay, sorry. Okay. I was going to say, that is one of the problems with how we study things in medicine, is that we sort of come up with these measures sometimes that are around what a pill does or what a deep brain surgery device does, but we really are unable to measure well the sort of patient-centered outcomes that are so important to patients or their caregivers. And I think that some of these things that are more about, you know, inner feelings or the motivation or other things are very unmeasurable, and sort of the group experience of the resonance that you get in a room maybe, or feeling your energy even through this virtual medium actually is kind of pretty spectacular. And I think other people have felt it here too. So we're definitely gonna link a lot of resources. There's been some comments about, Marjorie wanted to know, in the UK, are all of your groups called something specific, like Dance for Parkinson's, or is it something different in different places? People wanna know like kind of how to find you.
Sure, we do maintain a listing of all the classes that we know about around the world on our website. I'll post that link as well. Most of the classes are called some version of Dance for Parkinson's. There might be some different prepositions in there, dancing with Parkinson's, dancing through Parkinson's, but some version of that. There's some that have totally different titles, like Dance for Life or Rhythm and Grooves or whatever it is, but most of them are dancing with, through, or for Parkinson's. Okay. Dance for PD is sort of a trademark name, so we reserve that name for those teachers and programs that are certified and licensed by us. But there are excellent teachers throughout the network, even if they haven't gone through that certification program, so don't let that stop you. We're just, again, it's a way for us to do some quality control over who's using the name. And those certified teachers do have to go through extra training, and they have peer review of their class. So it is an extra step, but you'll see a number of great teachers in your community who may not yet be certified, but they're on the track to be certified.
And as you mentioned, the silver lining with the ability to interface through Zoom or even, you know, other virtual mechanisms, I think is lovely, because it might help. One of, you know, when you're speaking, I think I as I've gotten more interested in yoga and even care of different patient populations, accessibility has been increasingly important to me. And, you know, the word, you know, accessible is sometimes hard to define. Sometimes for us, it means a patient who's so remote that they may not even have an internet connection anywhere near them. They live on a farm somewhere rurally. And I take care of a lot of veterans that have some issues like that. And then, you know, there's people through stages of disease. And I hope that, you know, one can use some of the things and some of the stuff that we're teaching around thinking not just about the most early stage person, but even as people age, as people may change with their bodies throughout the stages of disease. It sounds like imagining, thinking about movement, some of the stuff that you were talking about could even be performed, you know, in a mental way, and possibly not throughout the range of motion physically, but even as people get sort of more immobile maybe, or more aged. Could you speak to maybe that?
Sure, so I mean, our classes, I think from the beginning, have always emphasized accessibility for a very wide range. We have people in our class who are newly diagnosed, who are really responding well to medication, or are fairly asymptomatic, all the way up to folks, I would say at stage four, who really want to keep coming, and they do keep coming. The challenge is actually just getting to the building. So in many ways, you know, this virtual space, the online space, is providing, it's a boon for them, because they're able to participate without having to deal with New York City transit, which is always a hassle. So, but one of the things that we do in our training is really emphasize the importance of having both a standing and a seated demonstration for everything that happens. You'll see that on all four of our instructional videos. There, every activity is shown, both a standing version and a seated version. And in class, we show different speeds of things. So for people who have more rigidity, who might be moving as well more slowly, can do it at a different tempo than others. And we try to provide a space for all of that to happen in a comfortable way. So it's also in the language that we use, right? So instead of saying, if you want to just do a slower version, or if you want to just do half as much, we really try to avoid that language. The word just can be very belittling. So saying people who would prefer to move at this speed, shown by this person, Shannon's going to show that. I'm going to show a version that's a little bit faster for people who want to go at that speed. It's your choice. So it's really about choice making and giving ownership over to the individual rather than creating a hierarchy in class. About 3 years ago, however, we did hit a point in our class where our group session was at a very like middle road in terms of trying to be accessible to a very wide range. And there were a number of folks who were really interested in pushing themselves more. They'd read Jay Albert's research on forced exercise. They knew about the tandem bike studies. But they liked dance. They didn't want to be on a bicycle all the time. So they said, how can dance bring us to that same kind of level of rigor? And could there be a separate class? And so about 3 years ago, we started a separate program called Dance for PD Pro, which takes place in the early evening, late afternoon, 5:45. And it's really a way for those living with young onset Parkinson's who are still working, who want to really push a little bit more, to come in and have that experience. So that's an all standing class. Not to say that if somebody needed to sit, they couldn't. Of course, they always can, but there isn't necessarily a seated model in that class. And that's a much more high intensity, full modern dance class that gets people sweating a bit more. It is more rigorous, it's more challenging material, there's more structured improvisation. Anyway, so that's been very successful. A lot of people do both. They come to that class and they also come to our regular group class. So yeah.
That's awesome. Yeah. I have another question that you triggered a thought from. So you had said that the UK, and I think somebody else mentioned this as well, the UK is kind of more ahead in the arts in health. Could you speak to that? And I've actually had to review some grants that have been written by some organizations as well from there. And I've just been interested in some of the things that are happening. It just seems interestingly progressive. So maybe you could speak to your understanding of what's going on there and help us maybe make some changes here in other countries. And I think we have a pretty international audience on this call. I know we have a couple of people from the UK, I think, on. And so maybe, you know, just enlighten us a little bit.
Yeah, in the UK, there are a couple factors. Number one, there's a National Health Service. So there's a unified healthcare system that is interested not only in principle in arts, but interested in ways to reduce their costs. And there have been some early studies to show that arts and health initiatives can significantly reduce costs, particularly in things like falls for older adults, which is a huge expense in the system when it's a single payer system. So that's been sort of pushing things forward. But there's more than that. I would say there's a better partnership and collaboration between research, policy, and practice than there is here. So we have really strong people in all those areas, but they don't necessarily come together to share. There have been a number of roundtables that take people right from the government, from policymakers, put them at the same table as researchers and the same table as practitioners, so people like me and others who are doing this work, and figure out a plan forward that's a national plan, a national model. For a variety of reasons I'm not going to get into on this call, we're a long way from that. You have to have a willing administration that actually understands the value of the arts in a healthcare model, that wants to talk to researchers, that values the impact of science. So There are a number of things that we're a bit behind on, but I think in the UK as well, just to be fair, it's a smaller country. They're able to do things on a national level in an easier way. Again, they don't have the healthcare patchwork that we have, the insurance patchwork that we have. We are seeing some inklings here. Kaiser Permanente, not surprisingly, has been kind of on the avant-garde of really embracing arts and health. They reached out to, for example, San Francisco Ballet and said, we want to partner with you to have a Dance for Parkinson's program for our members. So it is happening. Kaiser does it. Other insurance companies may do it. We might see it at some point being part of some of the Medicare Plus programs. Anyway, we're a long way from that, but it is starting to turn. But it's in the UK, it's a more cohesive system. There are more people talking to each other. It's easier to affect change through the National Health Service. As troubled as that service is, it is centralized. So that makes decision-making and policy changes towards an Arts for Health model a lot easier.
Interesting. Well, I think we've talked a lot on these COVID era talks on advocacy in Parkinson's and how to make changes. We were talking around the book Ending Parkinson's Disease on what people in their own communities can do. I think that, you know, starting small, maybe grabbing a couple of friends, you know, trying to start a group like yours, doing some maybe DVDs or some of your Zoom programs together, if you happen to be in a place that we don't have an organization already, it sounds like that would be a small way to start. And then I agree. I think that looking at a way to partner on a higher level with thinking about what's best for our patients. And it's just amazing to have people who are as energetic and positive as you, be part of the discussion and the dialogue, at least somewhere in the world. happy to help if I can. People are talking about other silver sneakers programs and things like that. So it sounds like there's people trying to do things in their own communities. David, would you be willing to, I know it's a bit of a surprise and we weren't really like thinking that we were going to do a ton of dancing, but maybe you could do even whatever you think you might be able to teach, if it's some part of your warm up, but wanted to get people a little bit of a taste of what you're doing. If you want to do it from the chair or standing, whatever makes sense. We've been, having people just get a little taste here of different offerings and then putting a lot of links in after the program, we'll put the video and then we'll put some links in anything you want to share for folks to be able to get on. And we definitely want to support local programs and help artists in general stay keeping the dream alive, because I know that's another huge group of folks that are hurting right now, out there. And so anything we can do to help connect patients maybe with programs in their local community and help, keep some of these programs alive would be so important for sure.
Thanks. I appreciate that. Yeah, no, I'm happy to do a little bit of movement. I think, the other challenge for us is really like walking that line between, if somebody mentioned silver sneakers, they can get that through insurance. Walking the line between still being an arts program, but having, clinical outcomes. And that's like, we know from the research that there are positive clinical outcomes. But for insurance companies, they need to see major cohort, big cohort studies, like 300, 400, 500 people. And that's hard for arts organizations to do. That's expensive. And so we're, as a nonprofit organization, to do that kind of research, to get to that place where Aetna or other companies are saying, oh yeah, we'll bring this into our programming, it can happen, but that's what is blocking it. And as somebody said, we're really good at drug trials, but a lot of money into drug trials, but not a lot into researching the value of yoga or researching the value of dance, which over the long term may be as valuable as some of those drugs, and certainly without any side effects.
Absolutely. And you said, I think we've had a lot of folks, we've had physical therapists, Becky Farley was on and stuff, and we've talked about the benefits of exercise and things like that, but then adding on the sort of mind-body approach or these other things, like it's like exercise plus in some ways with the sort of group interaction, the music, and the sort of social milieu that a lot of these other practices are practiced in that keep people almost wanting, craving, looking forward to that, and then sustaining, being able to sustain these things on in the long run, which you've been able to do in your studio, which just is really amazing for this many years to have brought something and grow it and research it. And I mean, these are very, very big barriers that you guys have really been able to fight against. And I really commend you for that.
Thanks. Thank you. Well, we keep fighting, and I think it's, you know, I was on a call this morning actually with arts and health contacts from Europe. And I think this is in many ways a moment, I think, for artists to say, we have an opportunity here to serve and to provide something valuable for society. And there isn't so much performance going on now. So a lot of dancers are pivoting into this kind of community work, which is great. You know, it's another silver lining. So I'm going to lead two very short activities. Just before I do, make sure you have a little room around you, be safe. You can do all of this seated. We're not going to be flinging around the room. Really just two little samples of kinds of things we do. The first is going to be an improv that I'm going to lead you through. And I've gone back to my real background, which again is not very inspiring, but just to enable you to see me a little bit better and not have the weird effects that sometimes happen with the virtual one. So I want you to imagine that you are, in one hand, you have a paintbrush, could be a pen as well. And I want you to think about sketching a little bit this space around you. Right, so just very gently, I'm gonna turn this up a little bit. I don't know if you can hear, any music?
Yeah.
Just gently creating whatever patterns in space you want. It could be squiggles, it could be circles, it could be lines. But see if you can allow that movement to be continuous. So even if you take a momentary pause, it kind of continues and flows into the next. Allow your mind to wander a little bit here. So as you take yourself out of your room and really focus on this imaginary canvas. I'm going to change hands. You can see that imaginary canvas all around you. So above you, under you, behind you. And if you like, you can pick up a second brush and start to paint two lines simultaneously. You might want to think about what color you're using. Is it an orange? Is it a vibrant red? Is it a gentle green? Try to see those lines wherever you are. Now, changing your style of painting. So thinking about creating little dots of color in that space. Imagining that you're painting your walls with little dots. I'm thinking of also the artist George Seurat, right? The pointillist created these incredible large-scale paintings all made up of tiny dabs of color. You can go at any speed. We've just changed the quality of your movement now, so it's very precise, really direct. And now thinking about throwing paint. So for artistic inspiration, thinking about Jackson Pollock, the great expressionist painter, these splatter paintings. So just kind of releasing paint from your fingers, throwing it out, make a mess on your walls. It's okay, somebody else will clean it up. Just throw it out there. You can throw it with a specific finger if you want, or your whole hand. Yeah, great. Nice. Just take a moment to take all that paint in your fingers, rub it together, and smear the walls. Right. And if you want to try to smear the edges of your frame a little bit, do that. I'm like painting your own frame here. Beautiful. Just allow your arms to soften down and relax. Go on with that for a little while, but I want to just show one other thing. So very good. It was really so exciting to see everybody moving together And I do these in classes regularly, but this is a very imaginative group for sure. So very good work. All right. Let's go and just do one more thing. So
a few more things. Yeah, we have 15 right. minutes. So we can leave you 2 minutes at the end to give us something inspiring to close with, unless you want to say something, but totally happy to have you do a few of these. These are so much fun, for sure.
Okay. I see some other questions coming up too, so I do want to address them. But yeah, let's do it. It's baseball season, folks. So we're going to do a little baseball dance. So we're just going to basically go through a couple different moves together, and then we'll try with some music. So we're going to, I should say a couple different roles. So the first is the catcher. So you know, catchers have their own code, curveball, fastball, slider. You can invent your own with your hands. So can't really see my hands, but they're going to be down where a catcher would have hands, right? Great. We're then going to change into the role of a pitcher. And I want you to think about pitching forward. Mm-hmm. Then you're going to be the batter, thinking about a big twist and swing both sides. You've hit the ball, you're going to run. You can do slow motion, because all sporting events love slow motion. And you're going to do a slide into first base. This might also look like Fred Astaire. Actually, it looks like my image here. You can see. Here we go. I'm sliding into first base. So the slide is really as long as you can through your arms. I'm also doing a little slide in place with my feet. That's totally up to you. We're going to do twice forward, and then we're going to run everything backwards, like you're running the instant replay in the other direction. So we're going to unslide. We're going to run backwards. Right, so bringing your hands in. You're gonna pull the bat out of the air. You're gonna pull the ball out of the air, and the catcher signs are the same. So just to get our brains thinking forward and back, I do this because it's something choreographers do all the time. It's called retrograde, right? We do one movement going one way, and then we go back through it and rewind. And it's a trick because it means you don't have to create new material. You already have material and it looks new, looks different. So we're gonna do that now with our baseball movement. Let me get some music up here. And here we go. Six, here we go, and catcher symbol. Anything you want, you can invent your own. All right, ready to pitch? Throwing that ball forward, taping on the other side. Great, grab that bat, swing. Home run, swing through. Other side, run. In place, and sliding into first base. Let's try it one more time, here we go. You want to make those symbols as big as you can to get into the pitcher. Going back. Low, make sure you have your follow through. Good, grabbing that bat, winding up, and good. Same thing again, other side. Run, you're not sure you're gonna make it. Go, sliding in. Rewind the tape. Go backwards. Running backwards. Grabbing the bat, and pulling. One more time, pulling it back. Take that ball right out of the air. Take that ball right out of the air. Good, catch some balls. Anything you want. One more time, from your stride, pull it back. Running backwards. Pulling that back, pulling it back. Ball right out of the air. Good. Let's create our own personal skating rule. Excellent. Good. That was a nice one. Kind of missing baseball right about now, right? I mean, it's May already, folks. All right, good. Let's do one more thing. 2 weeks ago, we did a special class because it was Shakespeare's birthday. And as you know, there's a lot of dance and arts that were influenced by the plays. So we did some stuff from Romeo and Juliet, Midsummer Night's Dream. We also did some stuff from West Side Story, which of course is based on Romeo and Juliet. So I just wanted to finish with a little Sharks and Jets action. So everybody here, choose which gang you are in. Could be the Sharks, could be the Jets, depends on your mood today. All right, you're gonna select one of those gangs. Okay, everybody's made a choice. All right, so we're gonna do some stuff together. I'm gonna shout out for Jets only, and then I'm gonna shout out for Sharks only, and then we'll come back together. Jets all the way. All right, Andrea, we know where you stand. Some basic movement. We're gonna start with some pointing. So this is like you're kind of signaling to the other gang that you're gonna come and rumble with them. Yeah, so really reaching out to them this way. Sharp points, good. We're gonna take a little shift side to side. You can do this in the chair. You can do it on your feet. I'm not really traveling at all. I'm just shifting. And you can add a little rhythm to this if you want. I'm not going to clap because if there's a delay, it gets really confusing. But finding that pulse, we're gonna expand and we're going to retreat. We're gonna expand and retreat a couple times. And then we're gonna expand 2, 3, 4. And I want you to pick a kind of an assertive pose, like you're about to rumble with somebody, or maybe you're doing a photo shoot for the poster of West Side Story, the Broadway show. Yeah, so up and pow. Yeah, so anything you want as we go along. I'll put some music on and I'll give you some cues depending on which gang you are in. All right, let's try it. Here we go. Just feeling that rhythm in your feet. Again, if there's a lag in the video, you really want to listen to the music. Don't follow necessarily my timing. Just kind of getting in the mood. Let your shoulders move, let your arms move. Feeling that energy from the music coming in the body. Let's all start pointing. You go at any speed you want. Go nicely. Evenly here, or if I want to go faster. Good. Just the Jets. Just the Jets pointing. And now just the Sharks. Good. All together with our rhythm, we do a step. I'm just shifting my weight from side to side. Everybody expanding together. Reach. And softening. And again. Big as you can. Right, now just the Jets. You're gonna expand, 2, 3, 4, and pow. Now just the Sharks, ready? Expand, 2, 3, 4, pow. Good, just the Jets again. We go 1, 2, 3, 4, pow. Just the Sharks, ready? Here you go, expand, 2, 3, 4, pow. Nice. And now all together, everybody. 1, 2, 3, 4, pow. Good. Back to our points. All together. One. Even though we're kind of all on the same level, imagine that there are some opposing gang members at all levels, up and down. So you're really getting your focus in different directions. After all of that, thought we'd just take a moment, bring our hands together. This is the reconciliation part of the show. This is, I'm sorry that we fought. Let's make up. Hands together. Reaching out and trying to see everybody on your screen. I see you only got six people, but reaching out to each one of them. Same on the other side. Gathering energy in the front. Opening, pressing. Deep breath. Reach all the way up as far as you can. Let your hands gently rain down, trickle down. One more time, all the way up. This time, just a smear of that paint from before. I'm going to pause there because I do want to leave a little bit of time at the end for us to chat. Very good. So I think one of the messages, I love seeing some boxer dancers. There's a long tradition of boxer dancers out there, actually. People who've gone both ways. So people who were boxers and then became dancers, like the great Edward Vallela, New York City Ballet. And then a lot of boxers who trained and danced to get better at their boxing, like Sugar Ray Leonard or Muhammad Ali. So one thing I was going to mention is that dance is like the bread. You know, it fits well with lots of different fillings, whatever else you're doing, whether it's an exercise class, a boxing class, cycling, it supports those other activities. It gives you, you know, the motor skill, the timing, the space awareness that are going to support your other movement. But I did want to say that I love that last song, not just because it's a favorite song, but because I think there is a place for everybody in dance classes. Whatever your level of mobility, of ability, of comfort, dance class is a very safe, welcoming environment for everybody. So to go with the message of that song, yes, there is a place for you. There's a place for all of us within those dance communities.
Wow. Well, thank you so much. This has been really eye-opening. I've heard about your program and, great to see this and so much fun. And just, I mean, it just shows us how much music can also change the mood and you can, you know, do so much just even in your own imagination, thinking about these different, the paint, the baseball, the fighting with the other, you know, rival gang or whatever, can really bring out sort of pretty emotionally charged kind of feelings and in an energetic movement way, which is really amazing. So I really want to thank you for coming on, David, and your work and your dedication and your clear passion for this population that I also have a passion for, and really connecting us in this disconnected feeling kind of time, which has been really, I think, hard to do for many of us. But this will be on video, and I'm sure some of our patients will share with their other friends and family even, because I think you can, connect in such an amazing way, even with these virtual modalities. So I'm so glad that COVID hit when, in this time frame, not, 20, 30 years ago, when we didn't have anything like this to be able to connect us. But hopefully people can connect with each other, connect with your programs, learn, be sort of open-minded to, sort of letting this kind of wash over you a little bit, because I think that we have such a sense that dance means that you're wearing a cute ballerina outfit with a bunch of 16-year-olds in a room with super flexible people. But you were able to do this for, and I feel like even if you were in a bed and couldn't move, you could do some, get some benefits from this. So thank you so much. I really, you know, want to thank you for everything that you do and for joining us today. And thanks PMD Alliance for hosting this. And we'll put up a lot of resources. So please share with us anything you want to get out there.
Thank you so much for the opportunity. And thank you for joining us, everybody, today. Thank you for being willing to join us in the movement. It's real. I do encourage you to check out our classes. If you like what we did today, I teach every Monday through Zoom. So we'd love to see you on there. You'll be warmly welcomed. And thanks again to PMD Alliance for the invitation to share with you. Really grateful for that. Thank you.
Thank you. Back to you, Andrea.
This was a delightful way to kick off the weekend. And you all are all dancers. I was torn between dancing and watching your beautiful movements. And let's have a dance-inspired wave-off today. We always wave each other goodbye, David. So let's see if some of us are a little bit more jazzy than usual today. But thank you. Oh, that's good to do. Oh, that's a good one. Bye, everyone. Thank you so much. Have a great weekend. Thank you so much for joining us. Thank you, David. Thank you, Indo. This was amazing.
My pleasure.
Bye now.
Bye, guys. Bye. Mm-hmm.